friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear.
Chapter 2. I'll use this as an intro to the message. How would you respond if somebody that you were very close to was intentionally and unjustly killed? It may be unfair to use this as spouses. To use spouses as illustrations. It doesn't have to be spouses, but I could ask the question, Clyde, would you be upset if somebody killed Janet intentionally? You'd be upset. Yeah. Would your anger toward the person that did that to you consume your life? Probably. And I'll say for most of us, it would be the same way. How would you feel, Dave, if somebody did that to Linda?
Can't even imagine the anger.
I know that I've preached here the past couple weeks about discipleship, following, being a follower of Christ and following his example. Disciple means a learner, somebody that tries to learn from the teacher how to deal with things. And I've been challenged by Peter's ability to learn to be like Jesus, even when he suffers a loss. I've had you turn to chapter 2. I'm going to start down in the 19th verse. And this message may make more sense to you as we go along. But Peter writes this. He says, "For it is commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it?" In other words, if you got beat for doing something wrong, you got what you deserved. So you shouldn't feel like you're going to receive any sort of special blessing. You're just getting your due reward. But he says in the last part of that verse, "But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God." I don't like this next verse. He says, "To this you were called." What is it that we were called to? Apparently, suffering for doing good. You and I have been called to suffer for doing good. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you. Next phrase, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. So I read this about Peter, and Peter saying, you know, if you go through pain, and he's speaking primarily about if you're just busy doing good and you received all sorts of stuff from him, he says, look, this is part of what you're called to do. Understand that you're going to be following in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. Isn't it Jesus that ended up saying, "Blessed are you when men persecute you and say all manner of evil against you on my sake?" Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, because this is the way that they treated the prophets of old. There's going to be hardship as you go through life. And I guess I need to cut to the chase and let you know why this passage of Scripture is speaking so much to me. Look with me one other passage of Scripture, Acts chapter 12. I don't know how this message is going to go across this morning. I never know. Here's what I kind of want to use as a little bit of introductory material. I'm amazed at Peter's ability, whenever hardship and heartache came his way, that he still kept his eyes on pleasing the Lord. I used the illustration earlier, Clyde, about you and Janet. I'm afraid that if we suffered, and it's not just you, I think that everybody in here, Dave, kind of went along with your same sentiments. If something happened, bad happened, that was undeserved, it would consume our lives. We would be very angry about it. In fact, so much so that we might lose our focus on becoming or being a Christian. I don't even worry about trying to act like Christ. I'm so angry about what has been taken from me. And I marvel at Peter's ability. And again, the passage of Scripture that I read to us from 1 Peter. Peter's saying, look, Jesus has given us an example of how we should act if something happens that's undeserved. Jesus has shown us how we should act. And Peter bought into that and he tried to follow. Here's why I've had you turn to Acts chapter 12. What does Acts chapter 12 say? It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. And when he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. After arresting Peter, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. I believe he was going to kill Peter. So, anyhow, I don't want to focus so much upon, you know, Peter's almost getting killed. By the way, the rest of that chapter talks about the way that Peter was miraculously delivered from prison. And it talks about the church was fervently praying for Peter. And I believe that there is power in prayer. I just end up wondering why God decided to deliver Peter from prison, but he did not deliver James from prison. I really want to focus from this passage of Scripture that it said that James, the brother of John, was killed. And I know there's probably an unfair comparison here to compare the loss of, you know, a spouse to the relationship that Peter had with James. But I got to thinking about the close relationship that Peter had with James all through Scripture. I don't know if you'd stop to think about it, but we know that Peter was called to be one of the Lord's disciples at the same time that James was called. You remember the story? I think it's over in, if I'm not mistaken, Luke chapter 5, I think I wrote down. But it talks about in Luke chapter 5 that Peter and Andrew were down at the sea, and they'd been fishing. In fact, one of the passages of Scripture says that Jesus was speaking to a large group of people, and he noticed that the fishing boat was here, and he said to the person that had the boat, who was Peter, says, look, things are getting kind of crowded here with everybody coming around. Would you do me a favor, let me get in your boat, and we'll push out a little bit from the shore, and that'll give me some room to kind of speak to everybody. And Peter said, sure, we can do that. And he pushed out from shore, and Jesus turns around to the people, and he starts preaching to the people. And after Jesus had finished preaching to the people, he said to Peter, he says, would you like to catch some fish? I mean, it's not worded that way, but Peter said, yeah, I'd like to catch some fish. Jesus said, well, here's a suggestion for you. Let down your net over the side of the boat here, and you'll catch some fish. And Peter kind of like,
are you kidding me?
You got to be kidding me.
All night I fished.
We were here all night. And the reason that they did fish up night is because the fish would come in close to the shore. It says, you know, we fished all night, we didn't catch anything, but if you think that the daytime is going to be any different, we'll try it your way. So he dropped the net overboard, and he had so many fish, he hollers at his buddies. Peter and Andrew have two buddies up the way in their boat. What were their buddies' names?
James and John.
These were guys that fished together. Any of y'all know anything about fishing buddies? They're thick as thieves. I can't say it for sure, but I think that they're actually closer than golfing buddies. I'm not for sure. Don't quote me on that. But I think that they actually are. James and John, they grab their boat and they go out there and they drop their nets, and they've got so many fish that both of the boats, the scripture says, both of the boats are in danger of sinking. The nets even start to tear. And somehow they manage to drag all of that fish up there to the edge of the sea, and Jesus says, I got a proposal. And he said this not just to Peter, but apparently he said it to James and John too, because it says that Peter, Andrew, James, and John, all four of these guys said, you want us to be your disciples? We're in it with you. And so they walked away from those boats. I'll tell you something. You got to have a mighty good reason to get a fisherman to give up fishing. It is in their blood. And those guys walked away from those boats, I think I mentioned last week, as part of the message. I am intrigued by the fact that Peter was willing to walk away from a livelihood. I don't know how these guys went home and talked with their families. And by the way, Peter was married at the time, and whether or not he had any children, I don't know. But we do know from Scripture that Peter had a mother-in-law. And I don't know how Peter came home and told his wife, hey, honey, don't have to worry about me getting up to go fishing anymore. I'm becoming a disciple of Jesus. And she says, well, that's nice. Who's going to put food on the table? Who's going to pay the bills? And Peter says, I don't know, honey, but this is what I feel like God wants me to do, and I'm going to do it. And it wasn't just Peter that did this. Andrew did this. James and John, all of them, they gave up what they were doing in order to follow Jesus. And Peter was saying, you know, one of the reasons why I'm going with Jesus, I want to learn how God wants me to act. You know, that's what discipleship really is. Discipleship means that you and I want to learn how God wants us to act. That wasn't the only time that Peter is mentioned along with James and John. I've kind of made a list of things here. It says in Mark chapter 1, verse 29, that when Peter's mother-in-law was sick, and that would have been Peter and Andrew's, well, been Andrew's brother's mother-in-law. But anyhow, who went to the house? James and John went with Peter and Andrew. These were guys that they visited each other's homes on a regular basis. Scripture says over in Mark chapter 5 or Luke chapter 8, when Jairus was raised from the dead, Jairus' daughter was raised from the dead. You remember the story? The guy came to Jesus, says, come help my daughter. She's about dead. And before Jesus could go see her, somebody came and says, don't bother the teacher anymore. The little girl that you love, she's passed away. You might as well just let him go. And Jesus looks at him and says, just don't fear. Let me go. And Jesus went there to the home of Jairus. And who did he take with him? Peter, James, and John. And I'm only saying these stories because the Scripture talks about the closeness of Peter and James and John. When they went to the transfiguration, when Jesus took the disciples up on the mountain and he was transfigured, who did Jesus take with him? Peter, James, and John. When Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane, he left the disciples in one place, but he said to three other guys, you guys come with me away from everybody else. Who was it? Peter, James, and John. And actually, in Mark chapter 13, Jesus was talking about signs of the end of the age. And it says specifically there were four people of Jesus. Peter, James, John, and Andrew. And I give you all that information because I get the impression as I read Scripture, Peter and James must have been really close. And yet I read in Acts chapter 12 that Herod has James put to death. And I use the illustration about if you had somebody that was really close to you that got killed, how would it make you feel? And I asked you a question, Clyde admitted, and by the way, Clyde's about as even-tempered a person as you'll ever run into. I say that to his credit. I think his wife Janet said that she only seen him angry one time. Am I right? She said she didn't ever want to see him angry again. I was kidding with April in Sunday school class this morning. I can't imagine April ever getting mad. But I'm just saying, Dave, if somebody killed somebody that was very close to me, it would become an all-consuming anger. Because this is so wrong. And yet the passage of Scripture that I had us read this morning from 1 Peter chapter 2, Peter says, if something bad like that happens to you, leave it in the hands of God and keep your eyes on God. Let God take care of it in His time. And then Peter, in order to encourage us to do that, says, look, folks, you and I need to follow the example of Jesus. Jesus, rather than lashing out at those that were insulting Him, those that were hurting Him and whatnot, Jesus ended up just kind of stoically taking. What was it that we read this morning from our devotional reading, our responsive reading? Wasn't it from Isaiah chapter 53 and all the stuff that Jesus went through for us? You know, Peter at one time was not the person that he should have been. I think when they came to arrest Jesus, Peter, who just a short time before had said to Jesus, you know, Lord, if everybody else abandons you, I won't abandon you. You can count on me. I'll defend you. I'll stand up for you. So when they came to take Jesus away, Peter did what? Yanked out a sword. Went to take off Malchus's head. I believe that's what he was looking for. He wasn't just trying to cut the guy's ear. He was trying to sever his neck. And I think, I mean, I don't have any proof for it. I think the guy kind of ducked. And Malchus got part of his ear. Because the Scripture does name the guy's name. Cut off part of his ear. And Jesus said what? Put your sword away. Peter, you want to be a disciple? You want to be a learner? This is not the way to handle the situation. Those who live by the sword,
die by
the sword. Jesus went over there and grabbed up a piece of that man's ear and said, sir, come over here. And he put that man's ear back on. I preached the message this morning because I don't want this to happen to any of us. But I'm almost fearful that if it hasn't happened to you already, it will. If you're going to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, meaning a learner, you and I need to learn the way that Jesus handles things. And that's what Peter says in that passage of Scripture. He says, look, Jesus gave us an example of how we should be dealing with these situations. When Jesus was insulted, he didn't strike back. When he had stuff done to him, he didn't strike back. He left it in the hands of God, and he tried to continue to honor God in every way. I want to tell you, if one of these injustices does come your way, you are in for the struggle of your life to follow the example of Jesus. Because every fiber of your being is going to say, I want to do it my way. And the Spirit of God will be there in the background saying, but if you do it your way, it's going to make things worse. You know, if you stop to think about it, isn't that what sin is all about? Isn't sin about us? And if you want to go back to the Garden of Eden, what happened in the Garden of Eden? Adam and Eve ate from a tree. What tree was it that they ate from? Was it the tree of life? No, it wasn't the tree of life. It was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. People say, well, what does that mean? I'll tell you what it means. This is what it means for me as a pastor. It means that rather than trusting God to make the decision about what is good and what is evil, trusting God to be the one that decides how you and I should respond to things, we start making the decision. Isn't that what Satan said? Why do you need to trust God? Do you not understand that if you eat from this, you will become like God, and you will put yourself in a position that you can make the decision of what's right and wrong? You know what sin is all about? Sin is always about us doing things our way rather than God's way. God warns us many times clearly from His Word. Listen, if you do it this way, you're going to have problems down the road. And we say, that's what you say. I think I can still do it my way and it's going to be okay. And God says, You see, you've bought into the lie. God says, I'm the one that understands from the tree of knowledge of good and evil what's the right way to do things. And we buy into this. And we can still do it our way and things are going to be okay. And God says, no, it's not going to be okay. I'm going to throw this into the message, and this isn't to muddy the water, but I do want to say this, because I kind of used it as an illustration back in Sunday school class this morning. There is a time for everything under heaven. Isn't that what Ecclesiastes chapter 3 talks about? There is a time for peace, but there's also a time for war. And God can give us wisdom. I'll kind of throw this as an illustration. I'm thankful that I live in a free America, aren't you? Yeah. I just started reading this past week. One day while I was up there at my dad's up there with him in the hospital, I'd taken some books because he's not really wanted to do anything. He's not wanted to read. He's not wanted to watch television, anything like that. And so I'd taken a book up there, and it's actually talking about that back during the Revolutionary War with George Washington, there was a spy ring that Washington put in place that was really instrumental in us winning the war against the Britons. So I've been reading this interesting book. It talks about these secret six people that were basically in New York City that were working behind the scenes to give information to us because we were vastly outnumbered by the British and whatnot. But I've been reading this information and understanding a little bit about what life was like for these people back under the rule of Great Britain. And I tell you what, I am thankful, very thankful that I'm not under British rule anymore. There was a time, and I believe that it was God ordained, because the way that God miraculously delivered so that we were able to win that war We were vastly outnumbered. There is a time for war. There's also a time for peace. And I say I don't want to muddy the water. I can't just preach a message of pacifism. You know, that if somebody does you wrong, you just all the time say no. I used as an illustration in the back, if some kid or some gunman was going in the local school with a gun, and you had a gun, does the Bible say then that you just kind of put your gun away and say, well, I'm not supposed to do anything to hurt anybody else, so I'm just going to let this guy go into the school and start shooting kids left and right? No. There's a time for everything, and I want us to understand that about the passage of Scripture. But Jesus is trying to tell us through the example that most of us are not living in a situation like that. Many of us are living in situations where we've had a hurt that has been done to us, and we need to start rethinking the way that we're going to respond to it. And I use in particular Peter because there was a time that Peter, and I used as an illustration, that they came to arrest Jesus, and Peter was a man of action, and he says, you know, this is the way that I should handle the situation. And he chopped off that servant's ear. And Jesus said, no, not in this situation. That's not the way that I want you to handle yourself. I want you to follow my example, Peter. Trust God. God knows what's going on right now. And this is part of God's plan. Don't end up trying to take things in your own way. Step back and understand that God will work out things in His way. I'm going to close the message. But I'm also going to say to you, some of the people that I respect the most right now are people that are Christians across the ocean. I saved an email. This was from a couple months back. But it said, do you realize that in some of these countries, over there in Africa in particular, 10 Christians every single day are being killed for their faith. Nigeria is really bad right now because over in Nigeria, the Muslims are very much opposed to the Christians, and they will come raiding the villages at night, and they will kill indiscriminately. They kill men, women, children. They are particularly looking for the Christians, and it's just horrific. And I say that I admire these Christians over there because in spite of the deep hurts that they've had, they're still keeping their eyes upon Jesus, and their witness for Jesus Christ is reaching others for the cause of Christ. I pray that we never have to go through the hurt. Because I'll say this. Those people over there love their life every much as we do our lives. It hurts them every bit as much to watch a father or mother get slaughtered with a machete as it would hurt for us. Well, what those Christians over there have done is they said, you know what? We are learners, disciples of Jesus Christ. And we want to make sure that people see Jesus through how we act. And so in the midst of all of their pain and their hurt, they push that aside and they say, what's most important is not the pain in my heart. What's most important is the witness that I can give for Jesus. You know, 3 weeks or so ago when I started preaching this message, and it was back on Easter, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19-20, now that I'm risen, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go ye therefore and make disciples, learners of all nations. I want you people to be the ones to teach other people what a Christian is all about. I want you to learn from me how I want you to respond. And I want people to see not you. I want people to see me in you. Tough assignment? You bet it's a tough assignment. That's why Jesus gave us His Spirit. And He said, look, I am giving you my Spirit in order that my spirit might be there to help you, because you will never get it done on your own. Are you and I disciples of Christ, or people learning about Christianity through our way of living? It's tough to follow Christ's example, but it's the only way people will ever come to know Christ. Shall we pray? Father, as I said in my opening remarks, I don't know how the message was going to go this morning. I never know. I'm simply trying to preach what I feel you laying on my heart. And there are some here within the church that know my heart, hurts that I've experienced. And Father, it's very tough. It's very tough to remember to be like you. It's not anything like the hurt that Peter must have felt when his good buddy James got killed. It's nothing like the hurt that the Christians over in Nigeria and other places in Africa are dying daily, 10 a day, for their faith. The hurts that those poor people live with every day. And yet, as we've read from Scripture this morning, Peter learned that there was a different way to handle situations. Rather than becoming bitter and vindictive and angry so that our ability to see you is totally blinded by anger and hatred, Father, that there is a new way to handle things, a way that your Son taught us. That even when people were doing bad things to him and they were insulting him, rather than lashing back, he learned to just trust in you. Father, may we learn to trust in you and realize that by doing so, we are following the example of Jesus Christ. We became Christians, yes, to go to heaven, but we also became Christians to become learners of how we should live our lives. Use the message within our lives today to help us to work to become more like your Son. May your Spirit strengthen us. If there's anybody that does not know Jesus, may they this day come to give their heart to Him. Jesus saves. As we sing a hymn of invitation, Father, use this for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please stand and turn to 697.